Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We invite you to get your Bible and join us. If you care to, we're going to pick it up 1 Kings chapter 13, verse 12. And in our last lesson, Jeroboam, whom God tore away 10 of the tribes of Israel and gave them to him, he became the king of Israel, the 10 tribes to the north, meaning. And he wasn't doing very well. He was making two golden calves for the people of Israel to worship rather than going to Jerusalem and worshiping Yahweh. He was consecrating his own priest, and even the lowest sort of people would do. He'd fill their hand and consecrate them as a priest of the house of Jeroboam. He made a festival in the eighth month on the 15th day, and he was offering incense when God sent a prophet out of Judah. And that prophet out of Judah prophesied to Jeroboam that there would be one named Josiah who would come. And that one Josiah would burn the bones of the false prophets on the altar at Bethel, the one that Jeroboam was utilizing to offer to the golden calves. And when that prophecy was said, it made Jeroboam angry, and he reached forth his hand to grab a hold of the prophet of Judah, and God struck him and paralyzed and withered his hand. And that got his attention for a short period of time anyway. He asked the prophet from Judah, "Well, would you please inquire of your God to restore my hand as it was?" The prophet out of Judah did so. The king Jeroboam tried to get the prophet out of Judah, who is also called the disobedient prophet. We'll find out why today. But he tried to get the disobedient prophet to come to his house and break bread and drink water. And he said, "And I'll give you a gift." And the prophet said, "The Lord told me, don't break bread, don't drink water. When you come home a different route than what you took there, and get on back to where you came from in Judah." Well, there was a couple of boys who witnessed all this happening, and they went and told their father, who was supposedly a prophet in Bethel. Well, let me tell you, at Bethel at this time, anybody with a righteous bone in their body and any prophet, true prophet of God, would have been headed south to Judah with the antics of Jeroboam. So that's where we pick it up today. And let's ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day. 1 Kings chapter 13, verse 12, and it reads, "And their father," this being the prophet of Bethel, "said unto them, what way went he? For his sons had seen what way the man of God went, which came from Judah." And note, the old prophet lived in Bethel. That's where one of the golden calves that Jeroboam had made was placed. Verse 13, "And he said unto his son, saddle me the ass. So they saddled him the ass, and he rode thereon." He wants to meet this man of God out of Judah. Verse 14, "And he went after the man of God and found him sitting under an oak. And he said unto him, art thou the man of God that camest from Judah? And he said, I am." I'm sure this prophet from Bethel, supposed prophet from Bethel, wants to know more. He heard about Josiah, and he probably wants to know, well, when is Josiah coming? Well, we know from biblical history it would be 360 years later. But this old prophet didn't know, the false prophet from Bethel. He probably wants to know more about these men's bones, the prophets of the golden calves that were going to be burnt on the altar, desecrating it. Whose bones are you talking about it? Could they be mine? Verse 15, then he said unto him, come home with me and eat bread. And in verse 9, the prophet out of Judah, the disobedient prophet, stated that God had commanded him to eat no bread nor drink any water, and choose a different route coming home than what you went. Verse 16, and he said, I may not return with thee, nor go in with thee, neither will I eat bread nor drink water with thee in this place. You don't break bread with idolaters, you don't drink water with idolaters. And this is a second witness that God had commanded this disobedient prophet not to break bread, not to drink water, and to change his route coming home. He would have been better off at this point to left things as they were and to get be on his way per God's instructions. He didn't. Verse 17, for it was said to me, this is the disobedient prophet, by the word of the Lord, thou shalt eat no bread nor drink water there, nor turn again to go by the way that thou camest. And so far, he's doing a good job of obeying God's word. And you know, many people have trouble understanding the verses that are that we're about to cover. And let me preface it by saying that, and when I don't understand God's word, I always ask myself, what lesson would God have us learn from this? And I think there's a very important lesson in this, especially for God's election. You see, God has to have people that he can depend on. And when he tells one of his elect to do something, he expects it to be done. When he gives you a mission, he expects you to take care of it and not to be sidetracked, not to lose focus. And that's what happens here to this disobedient servant. He listens to lies rather than focusing on the word of God. And I tell you this, beloved, there's one coming who, when he speaks of a lie, he speaks of his own because he's the father of it. And that's John chapter 8, verse 44, I'm quoting. His name is Satan, and he's got a role to play as the Antichrist. Revelation chapter 12, verse 15, he's going to have a flood of lies, and if you're easily deceived by the words of another man or by even the words of the Antichrist, it could cost you your soul. It could be lead you to cause commit the unforgivable sin. The penalty for that is death of the soul. Verse 18. He, this is the false prophet of Bethel, said unto him, I am a prophet also, as thou art. And an angel spake unto me by the word of the Lord, saying, bring him back with thee into thine house, that he may eat bread and drink water. But he lied unto him. Be very careful. Put yourself in the man of God's shoes. Understand that God very, very seldomly changes his mind. Take the prophecy of Psalm 22, for example. And if ever there was a prophecy that God wishes he could have changed his mind on, it probably would be Psalm 22. Almost 1,000 years before the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, it was prophesied. No, God didn't change his mind about his only begotten son being crucified on the cross. God certainly wouldn't have changed his mind about his instruction to the disobedient prophet to not break bread, not drink water, and to get out of there by a different route. You know, a prophet of God doesn't need another prophet, especially a man, to communicate God's word to him. Lord knows how many prophets we've had show up here at Shepherd's Chapel in Gravett. God told me, and this is what they say, God told me to come here to tell you, and we're always very quick to let them know that if God has a message that he wants us to have, he will communicate it himself. He doesn't need some man to communicate his wishes to us. And the disobedient prophet should have realized that as well. Verse 19, so he went back with him and did eat bread in his house and drank water, disobeying God for the words of a man that lies. Verse 20, and it came to pass as they sat at the table that the word of the Lord came unto the prophet that brought him back. This is the old prophet of Bethel. He was speaking falsely up to this point, deceitfully. He lied, but now he's going to be used by God. This just goes to show that God can use whomsoever he will, but he's about to give some true prophecy, and we're going to see it fulfilled in today's lesson. Verse 21. And he cried unto the man of God that came from Judah, saying, thus saith the Lord, for as much as thou hast disobeyed the mouth of the Lord, and hast not kept the commandment which the Lord thy God commanded thee, again, this is true prophecy, the phrase here, thou hast disobeyed the mouth of the Lord, it's the same phrase in the original languages used of Moses and Aaron in Numbers chapter 20 when they were bringing the water forth out of the rock of Meribah, and they rebelled against the mouth of the Lord. Very serious thing to do. It cost Moses and Aaron their journey's conclusion in the promised land. Neither of them was allowed to go into the promised land because they rebelled against the word of the Lord. Verse 22, but camest back and hast eaten bread and drunk water in the place, in this idolatrous place, meaning, of the which the Lord did say to thee, eat no bread and drink no water, thy carcass shall not come unto the sepulchre of thy fathers. In other words, disobedient prophet, you're not going to make it home. You're not going to be buried in the place of your fathers. In other words, you're going to meet an untimely death. Verse 23, and it came to pass after he had eaten bread and after he had drunk that he saddled for him the ass, to wit, or that is to say, for the prophet whom he had brought back. And the prophecy of Josiah coming would take some 360 years to be fulfilled. The prophecy of the prophet of Bethel that this disobedient prophet would not make it home and would suffer an untimely death won't take anywhere near as long to be fulfilled. And when he was gone, a lion met him by the way and slew him, and his carcass was cast in the way, and the ass stood by it. The lion also stood by the carcass. Now this is not normal. You see, a lion normally does not kill unless it's for food. Did he eat the disobedient servant? No, he just stood there by his carcass. And did he attack the ass that the disobedient prophet was riding on? No, he was just standing there as well. This shows that this was definitely of our Heavenly Father who brought this to be fulfilled. 25, and behold, men passed by and saw the carcass cast in the way, and the lion standing by the carcass, and they came and told it in the city where the old prophet dwelt, back to Bethel. Verse 26, and when the prophet that brought him back from the way heard thereof, He said, it is the man of God who was disobedient by listening to his lies, the alleged word of an angel through a false prophet, instead of the word of the God, unto the word of the Lord. Therefore the Lord hath delivered him unto the lion, which hath torn him, in the Hebrew this is broken him, and slain him, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake unto him. His lie was the main cause of that coming to pass. The elect, the message to you, obey the word of God. If you don't, you could face the second death. 27, and he spake to his sons, this is the old prophet in Bethel, saying, saddle me the ass, and they saddled him. He wants to see that the disobedient prophet at least receives a decent burial. Perhaps he's feeling a little bit guilty in that it was by his lies that the disobedient prophet came back and did break bread and drink water. Perhaps he has another motive. 28, and he went and found his carcass cast in the way, and the ass and the lion standing by the carcass. And the lion had not eaten the carcass, nor torn, nor broken, in the Hebrew, the ass. Why? Because of divine control. God in charge, verse 29. And the prophet took up the carcass of the man of God and laid it upon the ass and brought it back. And the old prophet came to the city, to Bethel, to mourn and to bury him. Again, what is the motive of this old man? And he laid his carcass in his own grave, in his own sepulcher that he had prepared for himself. And they mourned over him, saying, alas, my brother. This is a common lamentation, the alas, my brother. In Jeremiah chapter 22, verse 18, we learn that they would not say this lamentation for the one who was prophesied to come in 360 years, Josiah's son, Jehoiakim. They would not say, alas, my brother, when he died, or any other sad lamentation. Why? Because he was such an evil, notorious leader and king that they said, thank God he's dead. They didn't care, in other words. Verse 31. And it came to pass, after he had buried him, that he spake to his sons, saying, when I am dead, then bury me in the sepulcher wherein the man of God is buried. Lay my bones beside his bones. What was his motive? Well, you can read about the prophecy that Josiah would come in 360 years in 2 Kings chapter 23, verse 17 and 18. We'll be getting there eventually. And when Josiah was hard at work burning the bones of all these false prophets on the altar at Bethel, desecrating it, he came upon the tomb, the sepulcher, that this old man and the disobedient prophet were buried in. And he said, wait a minute, what does that say on the sepulcher? And they read it to him. It says, here lies the prophet that came from Bethel, and saying which he cried by the word of the Lord against the altar in Bethel, and prophesied Josiah would come. And Josiah instructed them, leave that sepulcher alone. So the bones of the disobedient prophet and the false prophet buried in the same tomb were not disturbed. That was the motive of going, of the false prophet in going and bringing the prophet, the disobedience prophet's carcass back and burying them in his own sepulcher. 32, for the saying which he cried, this is the saying that the disobedient prophet cried by the word of the Lord against the altar in Bethel, and against all the houses of the high places which are in the cities of Samaria, shall surely come to pass. Josiah did come 360 years exactly as prophesied, and the old man said, I don't want my bones to be burned on the idolatrous altars. Don't let Samaria throw you. Samaria would later become the capital of the 10 tribes to the north, and the name Samaria became synonymous with the 10 tribes of Israel. Israel and Samaria meaning the same thing. Verse 33, after this thing, Jeroboam returned not from his evil way. The withered hand didn't get his attention, and the prophecy of the altar was rent by an earthquake. You may recall in our last lecture, and the ashes spilled out on the ground. None of that affected Jeroboam for any length of time, but made again of the lowest of the people priest of the high places. Anyone would do. Whosoever would, he consecrated him, and he became one of the priests of the high places. More like it, a priest of Jeroboam. The prophecy of the man of God didn't change Jeroboam's feelings or his actions at all. Verse 34, and this thing became sin unto the house of Jeroboam, even to cut it off and to destroy it from off the face of the earth. And that would soon come to pass as well. It wouldn't be 360 years that Jeroboam would die and his male descendants be cut off forever. And you might say, well, that sounds like the sons of Jeroboam were punished for Jeroboam's actions. Well, you see, it wasn't just Jeroboam. The people of Israel had fallen off into idolatry. They were worshiping the golden calves. They were making their Ashtaroth, the male phallic symbol, and they were practicing idolatry. The demise of Jeroboam in chapter 14, let's go with verse 1. At that time, Abiah, the son of Jeroboam, fell sick. And what the sickness was, it's not stated, but it must have been a serious illness. We can read into that because of what Jeroboam does next. Verse 2, and Jeroboam said to his wife, arise, I pray thee, and disguise thyself, that thou not be known, that thou be not known to be the wife of Jeroboam, and get thee to Shiloh. Behold, there is Ahiah the prophet, which told me that I should be king over this people. We were introduced to Ahiah in chapter 12, when God said, you take your cloak and you rend it in 12 pieces and you give 10 pieces to Jeroboam. And Jeroboam, we'll see, he had no confidence in his own gods, small g. The two golden calves were simply politically expedient. He didn't seem to listen to the disobedient prophet, but here he's seeking the word of a true prophet of God, Ahiah. I'm sure at this point, though, God is thinking, Jeroboam, why don't you ask your two golden calves what's going to be the outcome for your son, Abiah? Verse 3, and take with thee 10 loaves and cracknels, these are cakes, and a cruse or a bottle of honey, and go to him, referring to Ahiah the prophet, he shall tell thee what shall become of the child. And these are small gifts that any commoner would bring to someone such as Ahiah the prophet. In other words, he didn't send gold or silver, which would indicate this was coming from someone of influence or riches anyway. He's having her dressed down so that she supposedly won't be recognized as the wife of the king of Israel. And Jeroboam's wife did so. and arose and went to Shiloh, that's the home of Abiah, and came to the house of Abiah. But Abiah could not see, for his eyes were set by reason of his age. He had become blind over the years. Now, and it's kind of ironic here, we have Ahiah, whose physical eyes are shut, but his spiritual eyes are open. And we have Jeroboam, whose physical eyes are open, but he's spiritually blind as a bat. What are they trying to do here? Jeroboam's trying to deceive a prophet of God. And when you try and deceive a prophet of God, you're trying to deceive God himself. And you cannot con God. He's going to try. And the Lord said unto Ahiah, behold, the wife of Jeroboam cometh to ask a thing of thee for her son, for he is sick. Thus and thus shalt thou say unto her, for it shall be when she cometh in that she shall feign, she'll pretend herself to be another woman. Again, trying to con God. But God knows your heart and your mind. He already knows what Jeroboam and his wife are up to. And it was so when Ahiah heard the sound of her feet as she came in at the door, that he said, come in, thou wife of Jeroboam. Why feignest, or why do you pretend thou thyself to be another? For I am sent to thee with heavy or hard tidings. Now, I bet this set Jeroboam's wife back. Here, he already knows who she is, and he's blind to be on top of that. But he's saying, not only do I know who you are, I've got some bad news for you. Verse 7. Go tell Jeroboam, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, for as much as I exalted thee from among the people and made thee prince over my people Israel, I made you king over the 10 tribes of Israel. And he made some promises to Jeroboam. There were conditions. The condition was that Jeroboam do things God's way and follow the commandments. Jeroboam didn't. He went so far as to fall off into idolatry. God doesn't like that. And it's going to cut off his, not only, and originally God promised Jeroboam, I'll give you a long line of successors to sit on the throne of Israel if you will do things my way. Well, their long line of successors are about to be cut off. Verse 8. And rent or tore the kingdom away from the house of David, and gave it thee, the 10 tribes. And yet thou hast not been as my servant David, who kept my commandments, and who followed me with all his heart, with all his mind, to do that only which was right in mine eyes. And here we see the kings of Judah often compared to David. Here, the first man-king of the 10 tribes of Israel after the split is being compared to David as well. Again, was David perfect? No, he wasn't. He fell short like the rest of us do in the flesh. But as far as his faithfulness to the Lord, he was unquestionable. He was unshakable in his worship of Yahweh. But Jeroboam, the golden calves, consecrating his own priest and making the festival in the eighth month on the 15th day, he'd gone too far. Verse 9. But hast done evil above all that were before thee. Now that's saying a lot. For thou hast gone and made thee other gods, small g, and molten images. You broke the first two commandments. The first commandment, you'll have no other gods before me. The second commandment, you shall have no graven images to bow down to worship. to provoke me to anger and hast cast me behind thy back. And that's dangerous. Cast me behind thy back, utilized only here and in Ezekiel 23:35. And it denotes a scornful contempt of God. And this is a complete opposite of what God expected from Jeroboam. He expected Jeroboam to keep God before his eyes and in his heart, and then he would give him a long line of successors. Rather than that, though, he got a scornful contempt. Verse 10, therefore, behold, I will bring evil or calamity upon the house of Jeroboam, and will cut off from Jeroboam him that pisseth against the wall. This means a figure of speech that means the male's descendants of Jeroboam, effectively wiping out his seed line, in other words, and him that is shut up and left in Israel, and will take away the remnant of the house of Jeroboam as a man taketh away dung till it be all gone. Dung, not very highly thought of, but that's what God thought of the house of Jeroboam. The shut up and left in Israel, it's a figure of speech that means someone who thinks that they're strengthened and fortified. In other words, that they're safe, but there is no place you can hide from God. Now, was this cruel and unusual punishment for Jeroboam? No, it was not. After all he had done, and then to turn around and fall into idolatry. Not only did he fall into idolatry, he led the ten tribes of Israel, the nation of Israel, to commit idolatry as well. Verse 11, him that dieth of Jeroboam in the city shall the dogs eat, and him that dieth in the field shall the fowls of the air eat, for the Lord hath spoken it. In other words, the descendants of Jeroboam will not even receive a decent burial. And you know, this is one of the curses of Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 26. That chapter, along with Leviticus 26, give us the curses and the blessings of God. Deuteronomy 28:26, you don't do things God's way, you won't receive a proper burial. Verse 12, arise therefore, the prophet tells the wife of Jeroboam, get thee to thine house, and when thy feet enter into the city, the child shall die. Abiah will die, and that's the immediate judgment of our Heavenly Father. The other prophecy will soon be fulfilled also. Verse 13, and all Israel shall mourn for him. He was the heir apparent to the throne, and bury him, for he only of Jeroboam shall come to the grave. Only Abiah would receive a proper burial, because in him there is found some good thing toward the Lord God of Israel in the house of Jeroboam. And it's not written what that one good thing or some good thing that Abiah did, but obviously he had some good about him, that he was given a decent burial. The other descendants of Jeroboam, not going to happen. We got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
Genesis 1:46. The first six chapters in God's Word. The world that was. Did you realize there was a world age before this one? Same old world, different age. The creation itself. When were the races created? You see, all the races were created separately, and you'll find that documented in these particular CDs. How and what was the sin in the garden? It will be discussed in this series also. This is a must for the serious Bible scholar. For if you do not understand how it was in the beginning, you certainly will never understand the end. I think you will find this series very rewarding, and certainly will answer questions that no doubt you have always wondered about. Genesis 1:46. Hey, I know you're going to enjoy this series.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the United States, and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to leave to possibly be answered on the air, feel free to call that 800 number and leave your question. Please don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We try to teach God's word in a positive manner, throwing out negative about others, especially our brothers and sisters in Christ, serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. If you're listening by shortwave radio or studying via the internet somewhere around the world that's unable to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in, being the point. Got a prayer request? We can do away with the telephone number. You don't need a paper and pencil and a mailing address. Talk to your Heavenly Father. I encourage you to make a little time each day, at least once a day, to talk with your Heavenly Father. It's a good way to keep the communication lines open. And you know, He will communicate with you if you communicate with Him. Your relationship with your Heavenly Father doesn't depend on Him. He's the same yesterday, He was the same today, He will be the same tomorrow. Man is the one who changes, and again, your relationship depends on you. I encourage you to take the ball and run with it. Talk to your Heavenly Father. We do have these prayer requests. Father, we ask you to look upon these. We come united as one in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Look upon these, Father. You know their needs. Illness, Father. Financial difficulties. You know, Father, if it's your will, a special blessing on each of these. We also remember our military troops and their families, Father, and we lift them up in prayer. Watch over, guide, direct, touch, heal in Jesus' precious name. Amen and thank you, Father. All right, and as promised, I'm going to bring up Glenn from New Jersey with our first question today. How does Matthew 25, verses 41 through 46 on eternal punishment square up to a consuming fire teaching? Well, it states there in Matthew 25, verse 41, that there is an everlasting fire. Well, let me tell you, Glenn, that once someone goes up in smoke, they are forever up in smoke. The lake of fire is temporary, and I know a lot of people like to think about, well, there's a eternal hell. Well, you know, and we learn in Revelation chapter 21 what the eternity is going to be like when God returns and wipes away the tears from all of his children. And there is no more death. There's no more pain. There's no more sorrow. Well, you know, I can't imagine there being an eternal lake of fire and some of our relatives are in the lake of fire just screaming bloody murder. And that's supposed to be heaven, the eternity. No more pain, no more sorrow, no more death. That doesn't add up. So the lake of fire is a temporary thing. Once it's gone forever. And Satan is gone forever as well. Praise the Lord. Evelyn in Oklahoma, thank you for your kind comments. Please explain 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 12. And that reads, "For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even also as I am known." And the glass in the Bible is a mirror. In other words, when I look into a mirror darkly, and that is darkly is in a riddle or baffling. In other words, when I look in a mirror, I'm baffled. But then face to face, now I know in part, but then shall I, et cetera, et cetera. But that's what the glass and darkly is talking about. Johnny in South Carolina, my question is, with all this fighting going on right now in the world, and it seems to keep getting worse. Are we just about to reach the sixth Trump? There's got to be a great deal of war going on before Pretty Boy Floyd can come in with his lying piece, right? I'm checking the news every day looking for the candlesticks in Israel. Matthew chapter 24, verse 6, we learn that when you hear of wars and rumors of wars, see that you be not troubled, for the end is not yet. And we've got a lot of wars, as you said, going on in the world. But things are going to happen just as God wants them to. You know, he's the one who decides, and we should leave it up to him and his wisdom and knowledge. No one knows, as Christ would say, the hour that the Son of Man, Jesus Christ, returns except the Heavenly Father. Beth in Florida, I'm a new Christian and I was wanting to know some verses that I might give to a friend for her salvation. I would give her John chapter 3, verse 16. Probably the most memorized verse in God's Word. Dalton in Texas, Air Force, retired Air Force veteran, and thank you for serving our country. Judges, please explain Judges 16:1. And I don't know what you're misunderstanding about that. It just states there in Judges 16:1 that Samson took a Philistine girl. Why would he take a Philistine girl? Well, God was in control. He was using that relationship to stir up trouble between Samson and the Philistine. You see, the Philistines were oppressing Israel terribly during the life of Samson. Samson was the beginning, the one who began the defeat of the Philistines. And you follow with the second, please explain 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4. And that states God put us in trust with the gospel, which is the good news, so we speak not as pleasing men, but God. And that simply means that if you're going to teach God's word, to teach the gospel, the good news, then you need to be worried about pleasing God, not men. All too many preachers are, unfortunately, all they're worried about is pleasing the congregation. They're afraid to upset their congregation with the truth of God's word. They just want to speak kind, easy words to their congregation. You don't have to understand the book of Revelations. You're going to be gone. Ernest in New Mexico. Is suicide the unforgivable sin? No, it's not the unforgivable sin. You find the unforgivable sin one of the places in Luke chapter 12, verse 13, and the following verses. And that, of course, is for the elect when they're delivered up to deny the Holy Spirit. That is unforgivable. Lisa in Nevada. Does God always answer everyone's prayers, no matter what? And if so, then why do people say that some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers? And I also wanted to say thank you for your teachings and the teaching us about God's word. Well, you're welcome. You know, always pray, Lisa and everyone else, always pray in God's will. You see, he knows more than what we do. He knows the future. And sometimes we might pray for something that would not be in our best interest. And in that case, an unanswered prayer would be a blessing. God watching out for your best interest, in other words. Michael from Oklahoma, I have a question. Where in the Bible can I find the food laws? Thank you and God bless you for your service. Well, you're welcome. And you'll find the food laws in two places, Leviticus chapter 11, also Deuteronomy chapter 14. and some would have you believe, well, that's Old Testament. And when Jesus Christ came, all the health laws changed. No, they didn't change. It's misunderstanding, misteaching of the New Testament. For example, Acts chapter 10, they say that that's God is saying that unclean animals are clean. That's not the point of Acts chapter 10 at all. Peter fell asleep, and when he woke up, he was really, really hungry. And God lowered a sheet of unclean animals and said, "Rise, Peter, and eat." And he said, "No, Lord, I've never let unclean food pass my lips." That happened two or three times. And then we learn what the real lesson of Acts chapter 10 was. The lesson to Peter was, you don't call any man unclean. Common is the word. Why? Because Cornelius, a Gentile, was about to come, and he wanted to hear the gospel, the good news. Luena in Ohio, can a Kenite be saved? Anyone can be saved who believes on Jesus Christ, even a Kenite. John 3:16, I just mentioned ago, tells us what it takes to be saved. A Kenite can do that. My question is about, and this is from Darlene from Wisconsin. In your opinion, is celebrating Halloween worshiping the devil? In my opinion, Halloween is worshiping the devil. But my thing is the children, they don't understand. Some of them are really dressed up cute and they enjoy getting the treats. Am I wrong for passing out candy to the children? I do my best to stay out of the devil's path. I love Jesus and all of God's children. Okay, I think the dangerous thing, Darlene, about telling children, for example, we don't celebrate Halloween or we don't celebrate Christmas because of our religion. You know, you do that to a young child, and the young child is not going to really like their religion very well. What I would recommend people do is explain to your children how the holiday originated and teach them the truth about when Jesus was conceived and when Jesus was born, and that we don't worship or celebrate evil in the case of Halloween. Buddy in Michigan, will Satan have any power to convince those that have already died in their flesh bodies? There seems to be a whole lot of Christians that don't understand the sixth trump, but do love the Lord. Will he be able to tempt those that have already died when he comes? Those who have died in the flesh, believing in Jesus Christ, are good to go. They're in the eternity. The Antichrist, who will be on earth, will have no effect on them whatsoever. And you know, that is why we teach the one-third who followed Satan in the first earth and heaven age are probably in the flesh right now. It would only be fair that those third who followed Satan in the first earth and heaven age are here on earth. In my opinion, that's the reason we see so much evil in the world. Excuse me, Janice in Nebraska. I am confused about Revelation 9:16, the 200,000. If these are Satan angels, do they come from the bad side of the gulf? And are these the angels kicked out of heaven in Revelation 12:9? If these angels aren't the 7,000 fallen angels, when do they get kicked out of heaven? Are the 200,000 angels, are they also fallen angels? Thank you, and God bless you and the staff. And thanks for remembering the staff, Janice. We have a very hard-working group of volunteers and employees here. Very few in number get a lot of God's word out. Okay, you're confused about the period of time that's being discussed. In Revelation 9:16, the 200,000 is talking about the army of angels that Gabriel and Michael fought against in Daniel chapter 10. It's not the same as the fallen angels who are booted out of heaven with Satan in Revelation chapter 12. Hope that helps. CC in Virginia, answering the big question, who made God? By reading Matthew is like telling a child, because I said so. It's good enough for me, but my niece and nephew, ages 5 and 11, say, that's not an answer. Could you answer that question so that a child would be satisfied? Well, I hope so. In Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, when God appeared to Moses and he gave Moses instruction and said, I want you to go back down and tell the people of Israel this and that and such and such. And Moses said, you know, who should I tell them sent me? And the Lord told Moses, you tell them, I am that I am sent you. And the I am that I am in the Hebrew, Iyah Asher Iyah, it's the etymology of the sacred name, which is hidden in acrostics and five times in the book of Esther. It's found in the book of Psalms. And of course, his name is Yahweh, YHVH. But Iyah Asher Iyah means I will be what I will be or become. And another thing you might consider is the eternity. You know, an eternity means there was no beginning and there is no end. And our Heavenly Father was certainly been here for an eternity. There was no beginning for him. He has always been. It's difficult for a 5 and 11-year-old to understand, I'm sure. Andrew in Missouri, please explain the 6th and 7th trump. Well, Matthew 24 and Mark 13 cover the trumps. And I'd encourage you, if you haven't made a study with Pastor Arnold Murray, there's one tape called Matthew 24, Mark 13 that covers both, and I'd suggest you get that CD if you haven't already studied it. But what happens at the 6th trump? Well, the Antichrist is here on earth, and he's going to deceive the entire world, as it's written in Revelation chapter 13, with the exception of those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Those are the elect. He's going to be here pretending to be Jesus, and a lot are going to be deceived. At the 7th trump, Jesus returns. The second advent begins. You can read about that in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 52, and the following verses. In the twinkling of an eye at the last trump, that's the 7th trump, the Greek is very specific, the farthest one out, which is the 7th, then we lose these flesh bodies and the corruptible takes on the incorruptible. The incorruptible takes over the corruptible. Dixie in North Carolina. Were there Mamzars in the first earth age? No, there were no Mamzars in the first earth age. Why? There was no flesh man in the first earth age. What is a Mamzar? A Mamzar is one who is of an Israelite parent, for example, and a Gentile. That's what a Mamzar is. It's translated into the English in the King James Version Bible as bastard. David in California. What does Genesis chapter 9, verse 22 mean? Well, it's very mistaught by many, and many people teach that it's the beginning of the black race, which is an insult. Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father. And if you don't know what that means, you need to go to Leviticus chapter 18, verse 6, and Leviticus chapter 20, verse 11, where you learn that uncovering a man's nakedness means to lie with his wife. Ham had intercourse with Noah's wife, his own mother. Canaan was the result. That's the reason that Noah cursed Canaan. God didn't curse Canaan. Noah cursed Canaan and sent him away. Why? He didn't want a reminder of what happened running around. Robert in South Carolina. Is it wrong in God's eyes for a male who is committed to a female to live with her in a relationship if they're not married? Not much written in the Bible about marriage. In the Old Testament, when a man spread his skirt over a woman, they were married. In other words, they had intercourse, they were married. God is married, we can prove in Ezekiel chapter 16, verse 8, because he spread his skirt over Jebus, as it was called then, later to become known as Jerusalem. Gwen in Colorado, greetings and blessings back at you. My husband and I have a question regarding Matthew 40:41. And you mean Matthew 24:40 and 41. There are no chapters 40 and 41. We thought that the one taken are those that follow the Antichrist and the ones left are those that are waiting for the true Christ. Well, and Bullinger, and you point out Bullinger's comment, Bullinger died in 1915, you know, and a lot has happened since 1915. And was Bullinger perfect? No, but he was an excellent Christian scholar. Don't throw the baby out with the bath. I'm out of time. I love you because you enjoy studying our Father's Word in depth. He loves you because you read the letter that he wrote to you. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you. Won't you do that? And to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. There's one thing most important, though, and it's this. You stay in his word every day. Every day in your Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. Do you know why? Because Jesus is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645, 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
Mark, one of the apostles, Mark having been a very young lad at the time Christ walked this earth, was always in the shadows, observing and listening with the intensity that young ears can, picking up every word. And this great gospel moves very fast. But what a interesting and certainly impressive gospel it is for Mark, from those that young mind, reiterates to you in chapter 13 how some are going to be delivered up, exactly what they are supposed to do, and even in that 13th chapter giving you the seven events that fulfill this or make up the seven seals and the seven trumpets, and telling you how you are to react to them. A fast-moving gospel, one that I know you'll enjoy.
Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold.
The book of Peter. Here we have two books, 1st and 2nd Peter, that are absolutely fascinating. That great old fisherman telling us, leading us, directing us, guiding us, going into the depth, if you would, in that second book, into the three earth ages, giving the most...
Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
All right, good day to you. God bless you. Say welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel.